Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to the service of Holy Communion for Trinity Sunday. Having journeyed through the church's year, celebrating the birth and life of Jesus, his death and resurrection, his ascension on high, and finally last week, the gift of the Holy Spirit to all God's people, the revelation of God as a Trinity is now complete. And so today we celebrate that revelation of God as Trinity, that somehow mysteriously God is one God, but in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. A mystery we can't understand, but that leads us to awe and worship. Special warm welcome to any who are visiting with us here this morning. We're delighted to have you here. And a welcome to those watching online. The service can be followed in the green Holy Communion booklets you were handed as you came in. Welcome to our preacher for today, Canon Keith James, who is the acting archdeacon as well. And we're delighted to have you with us here today, Keith, and thrilled for all that you will have to share with us later on. So as we begin our time together, let's begin in praise and worship of God the Trinity with our opening hymn, Holy, 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 hymn number 276. Please would you stand? As we remain standing, let's begin our worship by praying our prayer of preparation at the top of page 2. We say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue singing God's praise with the words for our Gloria. We'll use not the ones in the booklet, but the ones that can be found at hymn number 414. Our collect for today. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you have given us your servants grace by the confession of a true faith to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity and in the power of the divine majesty to worship the unity. Keep us steadfast in this faith, that we may evermore be defended from all adversities. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please do be seated. At this point, I'll ask any children and young people to head to their groups. And as they do so, the notices you would have seen on the screen as you came in, and they'll be up there as you leave as well. There's nothing, I think, particularly happening this week that I want to draw your attention to. We turn now to our scripture readings. Both our readings today are quite short, but both speak about the work of all three persons of the Holy Trinity, the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And Jane Saunders will come to give us our first reading. Thank you, Jane.
Our first reading is taken from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 5, and this can be found on page 151 of the New Testament section of the Church Bibles. Romans 5, 1 to 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, in a moment, Ed will bring us our gospel reading, but before he does, we sing again, singing a great hymn to the Trinity, and a hymn that we're very privileged to have here at St. Andrew's, because not many other churches, I gather, will have it. The words are on the screen for our next hymn, words written by our very own Canon Ivan Bailey. So please stand to sing.
Thank you.
The Gospel reading is taken from John chapter 16, verses 12 to 15, which you can find in page 107 of the New Testament section of the Pew Bible. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
As we stand to prayer, Lord Jesus Christ, living and eternal Word, grant us a word to touch our hearts and minds, and so deepen our faith and trust in you. Amen.
Amen.
Do sit down. Friends, lovely to be here and to share in worship with you. Just great to be here. So, those of you with a sharp memory who've been in and around church maybe over the past few weeks will know that Jesus has given his disciples some parting gifts as he ascends to the Father, as he leaves behind his earthly ministry in the flesh. He doesn't leave his disciples without anything to hand. Instead, he gives some parting gifts. The first is a command. Love one another as I have loved you. By this the world will know that you are my disciples. That's the first of his parting gifts to them. Love one another, a command. Love one another as I have loved you. By this the world will know that you are my disciples. It's as if Jesus knew that disciples then, as now, were always going to be a collection of tricky people. It's as if he knew the full range of characters and personalities who would be drawn together by the gospel. John Bell, the Scottish preacher man, asked the question, what is God's favourite colour? Is it red because God is passionate and fiery? Is it green because God is generative and creative? Is it blue because God is peaceful and still? Is it gold because God is rich, warm, deep? No, he says, God's favourite colour is tartan. Hey, spoken as a good Scotsman. God's very self and being somehow seems to draw to himself such a wide range of personalities and characters, different and diverse people. And so Jesus knew that then as now, God's different and diverse people would need something to bring them together and hold them and commit them and bind them. And so he gives the first of his parting gifts, a command. Love one another as I have loved you. By this the world will know that you are my disciples. Bigger than personality preference, bigger than characteristics, is the call to love one another. Now, the thing is, of course, you're sitting there thinking, absolutely, because that's the sort of thing that Keith would say, because he's a vicar. It's how it rolls, of course. And maybe a little bit of you, the reptilian bit of you, the grounded bit of you, is already thinking, yeah, but you don't actually know the reality of my life. Okay? You will know that if you work with people, you know, voluntarily, in cafes and shops, schools, all sorts of community places, maybe even churches, you will know that from time to time you have that moment where you think, you know what, this would work really well if it wasn't for the people. it won't apply here, of course, but, you know, it often applies elsewhere. Yeah? You know that children's thing? Here's the church. Here's the steeple. Open the doors, and this is where all the problems begin. Yeah? Bigger than our differences and our diversity, Jesus gives a gift to bind us together and keep us working and committed to each other. Love one another as I have loved you. However, the reality is we know from our own experience, if we're honest, and the disciples certainly did, that the task of loving one another is profoundly demanding. Because of course, people like us are fine, aren't we? You know, it's the others. Yeah? You try and live in community, committed to one another, loving God's different and diverse people. Then, from time to time, and maybe even more than that, we discover just how demanding, stretching, and difficult that is, because we are so diverse and so different, and see things and believe things which are just so different from one another. And so God gives a second gift to his people. The first is a command through Jesus, love one another. The second, we heard about in that first reading, Paul's letter to the Romans. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which has been given to us. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which has been given to us to enable us to begin to love as God the Father loves. God pours out upon us the gift of his Spirit, which raised Jesus from the dead, which draws us deeper and deeper into God's life and our life together. On the difficult path to loving one another, so often we will discover just how poor and how empty we are when it comes to that business of loving one another. So God makes a gift, the gift of his Spirit, pouring his love into our hearts. There was a young trainee kind of monk who went to see a much older and more established monk in the community to talk about his spiritual life. And they sat down, and the younger monk began to talk about how his prayer life was, what he was thinking about it, the ideas he had. And as he was doing so, the older monk decided to get up, put the kettle on, made some tea, brought it across, teapot, teacups, saucers, all that sort of thing, sat it down. Younger monk's chatting away about his prayer life and all that's been happening. The older monk begins to pour the tea. Milk first, tea strainer, starts to pour the tea, fills it up, top of the cup, keeps on pouring, goes over the cup onto the saucer, keeps on pouring, goes beyond the saucer into the tray, goes beyond the tray, beyond the table and onto the floor. And eventually the younger monk says, "Stop! What are you doing? Can't you see that the cup is full?" "Exactly," said the older monk, "just like you. How can you expect to be filled when you're so full of stuff? For filling only comes to emptiness and poverty." And so it is in our own lives. It might sound like the worst of all news, that command to love one another as I have loved you, because the business of loving is just so stretching and demanding. If ever there is something which will teach us the limits of our patience and forbearance, if there's anything that will teach us how thin our patience is, how poor our inner life is, then it's the commitment to love God's different and diverse people. And it might sound like that experience is the most profoundly challenging thing, almost bad news, until actually we understand that our own inner poverty, which we discover afresh from time to time as we live in community with one another, that poverty of spirit and that emptiness is actually the angels which God gives to us, drawing us afresh to God himself and to the gift of his spirit. For he pours his spirit into our hearts that we might love as he loves. Don't avoid the void in your life. For the void and the emptiness and the struggle are angels which bring us to God himself and the gift of his spirit afresh, enabling us to love as God loves. It's a Native American story of a boy going to see his grandfather, and in the course of their conversation, asking him just why there is so much violence and anger and war in the world. And his grandfather thought for a moment, and he says, you know what? There are two dogs snarling and spitting and fighting in my heart. One is full of hatred and bitterness. One is full of love and mercy. And the little boy thought for a moment, and then he said, Grandfather, so which one's going to win? Grandfather said, the one that I feed will win. As we come to the Lord's table this morning, we offer not hands full of stuff, but our empty hands. We come offering our poverty and our struggle. It's our way of showing God our poverty of spirit as we seek to follow the way of Christ and love one another as he has loved us. It's so difficult to love God's different and diverse people, the people God has given to us in community. And yet knowing that we're empty, that we're poor in spirit, is actually to discover angels afresh, bringing us to God afresh and anew, inviting us not to feed on hatred and grudges, not to feed on resentment and rivalry, but to feed afresh on God's love and mercy. For God pours his love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which has been given to us. It's his parting gift to his people then and now. Amen.
Thank you, Keith, for those challenging words to us this morning. Let's begin our journey towards receiving from God by declaring our faith in this God as we stand to say together the Creed on page 4. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please do be seated as Jane Carey comes to lead us in a time of prayer.
Holy and blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three persons in one God, we worship you and adore you and acknowledge you as the one true God and Lord of all. In the power of the Spirit and in the union with Christ the Son, let us pray to the Father. Father, we pray to you for your church here in Eaton. Particularly at this time, we pray for our vicar, Phil, as he takes his sabbatical. We pray that he will benefit from the rest and refreshment that this will give him. We also pray for James, our curate, as he leads our church in Phil's absence. Please give him the time and strength for the task ahead and the extra work that this will entail. We thank you and pray for Sheila, our associate minister, Neil, our lay reader, and others who will take services and preach during this time. We pray for Lucy, our children and families worker, as she leaves her post at the end of this month and prepares for the arrival of their twins. Therefore, we pray for wisdom to know how to continue our ministry to young people over the coming months. We also pray for more help to be offered for the Sunday Club on Sunday mornings. Thank you for the success of our Platinum Jubilee Garden Party last Saturday, the good attendance and the excellent amount raised of £3,287 in aid of children and youth work in Eaton. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for our mission partners, Dick and Caroline Seed, who are now back in Cape Town, South Africa. We ask that they've found their flat and car to be in order after an attempted break-in whilst they were away on home leave in the UK. We pray for their safety and that of all staff and students at George Whitfield College, where they are based. They're currently organising lecturer training for Alexandria School of Theology in Egypt for this August, and for Uganda Christian University in December. We pray that all the funding will be available to do this training, because both institutions were not able to organise online training last year. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for the Queen and thank you that all the events for her Platinum Jubilee went well last weekend. We ask that she will soon recover from her mobility issues and be free from discomfort. Lord, in your mercy. The following prayers for the situation between Russia and Ukraine were written by Russian women and taken from baptist.org.uk. Father, we pray for the situation between Russia and Ukraine. We come to you with humble hearts as to the Lord of history, who holds the destiny of Ukraine and Russia in his hands. Lord, we come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, who brought your peace, shalom, to the earth. Forgive us when we do not abide in your peace. We pray for people of the land of Ukraine whose dreams, hope, health, properties, and life itself are damaged and destroyed. Be their hope, provider, and healer. We pray for children and mothers who are vulnerable and live in fear for years. Protect them, comfort them, and embrace them with your love. We pray for wisdom for the leaders of Ukraine and Russia. Guide them toward the path of peace. We pray for the world leaders, politicians, and diplomats making efforts to solve the tension between Ukraine and Russia. We pray for military forces that your commandment, you shall not kill, will have a mighty power over their hearts and minds. We proclaim your victory over all principalities and evil powers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for our government and ask that you will enable them to resolve the differences between some of them and their leader, our Prime Minister, Boris Johnson. We ask that they will deal effectively with the concerns that this country faces. Particularly, we pray that the problems with the rise in the cost of living and those of the imminent strikes of railway workers, British Telecom workers, and postal workers may be resolved as quickly and successfully as possible. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for those who are ill in our parish. We particularly pray for Alison Black, coping with her own health problems and caring for her husband, Alec, who is receiving palliative care at home. We also pray for Ruth Thorpe, our church office administrator, who after a few days in hospital because of her illness is now recovering at home. Father, please restore her to full health. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We also pray for the bereaved, including the family and friends of George Meadows, who sadly passed away peacefully on Sunday evening, the 29th of May, at home with his family. He was a much loved member of our church family for many years. His funeral will be in church at 11:30 a.m. on Thursday, the 23rd of June. Let us pause for a moment to remember any others known to us in silent prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Jane. As we prepare to come to this table, we turn to confess our sins using the words on page 6. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, have mercy. God the Father forgives us in Christ and heals us by the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore put away all anger and bitterness, all slander and malice, and confess our sins to God our Redeemer. Let's pause for a moment to reflect on the week that has been, and then we'll say these words at the bottom of page 6 together. We say together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs from under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation. and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him, and that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen. Well, as we share God's peace together, please would you stand? Peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father. Peace from his Son, Jesus Christ, who is our peace. Peace from the Holy Spirit, the life-giver. The peace of the triune God be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace. Well, as we prepare to gather around this table, let's sing our next hymn as we come with empty hands, waiting, wanting to receive all we need from God. Our next hymn is hymn number 271, Father in Heaven. Okay, I think, can we turn the sound system off and on again? Let's just pause for a moment whilst we see if we can sort that out, because it's quite an irritating sound. from this table. If you wouldn't say you are a follower of Jesus, we're delighted you're with us here this morning. Please either use this time as a time of reflection, or if you'd like to come forward to receive a prayer of blessing, you'd be very welcome to do so, and just leave your hands by your side to indicate that that is what you would like to receive. We'll be using Eucharistic Prayer E that can be found on page 12. God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you have revealed yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and live and reign in the perfect unity of love. Hold us firm in this faith, that we may know you in all your ways, and evermore rejoice in your eternal glory, who are three persons, yet one God, now and forever. Amen. We say together the prayer at the bottom of page 16. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, as we've been renewed and fed this morning by God's grace to us in word and sacrament, let's pray that now we would go from here into his world, confirmed and renewed in our faith in the God who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So we sing our final hymn, Affirm Anew the Threefold Name, hymn number 268. Please stand.